Today's episode is brought to you by Audible. Squat wisely with a brand new audiobook. Visit http://www.audibletrial.com/squat and get a free audiobook with your 30-day trial membership.
She is a passionate philosophy professor,
fitness professional,
and motivational speaker. She helps strengthen the body, but she also helps strengthen the mind.
The mind?
The mind.
For well over a decade, she has led philosophy courses within the University System of Georgia.
She leads group fitness classes in Atlanta,
as well as leading one-on-one personal training sessions. Let's all squat wisely with Kristen Hester.
Guys, I am very excited about the episode for today because the focus is all about minimalism. Minimalism is about basically living your life less clutter, with less stuff, needing less, and focusing on the desire to need less. A while ago, I was in a book club, and one of the books that we had to read is a very, very popular book. Many of you have probably heard about it, or you've at least seen it. Maybe you've read it, maybe you haven't paid it much attention. But the book is called The Life-Changing Magic of Tidying Up. And so the book is all about, you know, cleaning the house, but it comes from a very minimalist perspective and philosophy. Some of the people really rave about this book. Some of the people really hate the book. For me personally, I read that book cover to cover. For it to be a book about cleaning up, it is the most engaging book that you'll probably ever read about cleaning up. It's one of those books that as you're reading it, you're almost like, you feel like you're listening to, like, you know, Anthony Robbins give one of his motivational speeches or something. Like, it has you pumped about cleaning up. It has you pumped about getting rid of what is completely unnecessary in your space, in your life. Even though it's about cleaning, it really encourages you to look at the big picture of your life. You know, what have you invested in that was completely uncalled for consistently over and over again, to where now you have a mountain of unnecessary towels or books or whatever it is that you love? And I still think we should have those things that we like, but we don't need to like it in abundance. We don't need to overfill our home with so much clutter and things that are completely unnecessary. And it's a book that I highly recommend. It's actually one that I want to read again because it's one of those books that when you read it, you're like ready to like declutter your kitchen, your bathroom. I mean, she basically tells you, you need to just throw everything away for the most part. She's just that extreme. She'll tell you, like, there's a bunch of stuff right now in my bathroom that I'm sure I'm not using. It serves no purpose being in my home. It is not sparking joy, which is another thing that she talks about in the book. She even has a book now that I think is called Spark Joy. I'm not certain on that, but she talks a lot about sparking joy and how a lot of things that we have in our home serve absolutely no purpose. And all it does is create more financial problems for us, more stress for us. It just adds to the chaos and it's not even required, but we bring that into our home. We comfortably allow it without thought. And now is the time with minimalism that we become more mindful of, why do we purchase the things that we purchase? Why do we feel we have need of certain things? And why do we feel so obligated to acquire so much stuff when we're only going to use probably a fraction of it? So that is the focus of the episode for today. Look around wherever you are listening to this episode. You could be driving. If you are driving, how ironic. Maybe you can reflect on, do I really need this car? Or if I needed a car, did I really need to buy this car? Could I have purchased another car for maybe a better cost, better value than what I actually decided on in this vehicle? Maybe you're sitting in your home. You can look around and ask yourself, that corner over there, is that sparking joy? Do I ever pay that any attention 7 days out of the week? Do I ever take notice of that pile that's over there in that corner? If I don't, why is it there? I need to just get up, grab a trash bag, and probably throw away a lot of it, right? Well, if you read that book that I read, you'll be prompted to do that. You'll be encouraged to do it. And the crazy thing about it, you'll actually have fun throwing away a lot of the stuff you don't even need. So as you listen to my guest that's going to come up, he may even encourage you to just look at this whole lifestyle of minimalism from a perspective that you may want to embrace for yourself. He's going to offer some great wisdom. So please stay tuned, and we'll be right back with my guest after the break.
Jordis A1 Solutions has a fitness solution just for you. For your personal training needs, we serve clients who reside in Atlanta, Georgia, and nearby cities. We also help clients to achieve their goals online as well. To inquire, visit jordis.com. Jordis is J-O-R-T-I-S.
Thank you for listening to the Squat Wisely podcast. Today, I am welcoming Mr. Richard Bakare. I met Mr. Bakare on Facebook in a minimalism Facebook page, and he was telling the page about an awesome journey, his own journey that he started in Atlanta with minimalism. So I want to welcome Richard to the show. Welcome.
Thank you for having me.
Richard, tell us a little bit about who is Richard, and then explain to us how minimalism came into your life.
Okay, yeah, so about myself, I was born actually in Nigeria, but then grew up in Atlanta in the Decatur area. Spent some time living in California as a software engineer, and then recently just moved back to Atlanta a couple years ago. I've always described myself as kind of like a technology, fitness, and culture ninja. Is my catchphrase for myself when people ask who I am. And what that means is when it comes to those topics, I'm all in and I'm constantly experimenting with new ideas and trying to learn more about fitness, lifestyle, culture in a way that is about bettering myself and those around me. And professionally, I'm a solution architect and I work for a late stage billing software company in Silicon Valley. I think the second part of your question was kind of like, how did I come into minimalism? My whole life, I've kind of been a less is more thinker. Part of that is just circumstance and lifestyle. But I never really had the language, tools, and that cohesive vision for applying this minimalism philosophy to every facet of my life. And to be completely honest, it was after the election that I kind of came into this idea of, okay, I had a certain reaction to it. But what do I do? And I said, what do I do to have a positive impact on the things around me, regardless of who's in Washington? And in trying to do that and identify steps along that journey, I was struggling to find a clear head and train of thought. So I discovered the minimalism documentary on Netflix, watched that. And from there, I discovered all of the things that I didn't know about minimalism and the language, ethos, and philosophy around it, and a lot of other tools, the minimalism Facebook page and things of that nature. And that's how I've come into minimalism, and I'm trying to now apply that to every facet of my life.
Very nice. The thing that I really loved about your story was you sharing with us in the Facebook page how you have documented your experience being in Atlanta and without a vehicle. So walk us through that. How did all of that unfold? Tell us all about it.
Most of my adult life, I've had a car. My wife and I have had two cars, at least one at one stage in time. And as of late, we recently were looking at every facet of our life and we said, okay, Atlanta's a car culture, but does our life necessitate having a car? So we started to look at all of the financial aspects of it, the actual mobility and our day-to-day use. And when we looked at that, we realized, wait a minute, we don't necessarily need to own a car and we're really about experimenting and intentional living. Let's get away from it. So what we did was we waited for our lease to end on our last car and we said, we're going to give this a try. But I wanted to also document my experiment and my experience for other people and then give some tips and how to knowledge on what it's like to live in Atlanta without a car, especially because it's a very car first culture.
Definitely. So speaking about tips, let's deal with some of the pros and the cons.
Yeah. So financially, there were some benefits. The first thing we wanted to do was, we'll save money. Yes, of course, we'll save money on auto payments, the insurance aspect, parking, gas, fuel, maintenance, all of those things. So that's a big pro. So even when we factor in like the ride sharing costs, monthly motor passes, and purchasing an annual bike share membership, we found that we saved a significant amount of money. And more importantly, we weren't paying for 100% of a car that we're using 20% of the time. That was something that we wanted to think about. Another thing was the environmental part of it. So the satisfaction of knowing that, you know, we probably have a carbon neutral footprint and a better impact on the environment. And we weren't keeping a car around that we were only using 8,000 miles a year on. And lastly, we wanted to be, you know, I'm not into the pros entirely yet, but we wanted to be kind of counterculture, you know, and challenge that. But then once we got into the meat of it and started to actually go through the day to day, and I was logging the pros and cons, it got down to be some very specific parts of the experience that were awesome and some parts that were not so great. So what's great, you have a ton more time to walk around. And if you can kind of stand the summer heat and the winter chill, it's great for from a health impact. Well over 100,000 steps a week, so over 60-something miles a week of walking. I feel fit without having to run a bunch and work out a bunch. And we spend time walking our dog. A con, you got to plan ahead. You know, you can't do things as spontaneously as you would like, meaning you have to know when to book a zip car, the MARTA schedules, when they're running, when they're not, and plan for things like workarounds in case MARTA shuts down. But Lyft, Uber, they're there as a fallback for those last minute, I've got to get somewhere right now moments. Another pro was that because we had more time, we could pursue creative endeavors that we hadn't been pursuing. So my blogging has increased a lot. My wife's gotten into a lot more business consulting that she hasn't, you know, pursued in the past because she's put it to the side because we were sitting in hours of traffic trying to get from A to B. A con would be, you know, you miss out on those Sunday drives. I know that's kind of a weird thing, but if you've driven and you've driven in the South or just anywhere in America, there's always that one day you want to hop in the car. You know, I had a convertible at once, let the top down and enjoy the weather. You can always rent a car to do that, but, you know, we don't do that now. Another pro that I would like to mention would be not worrying about where to park. When we get to a destination, we go straight to what we're doing and we enjoy it. Moreover, we can drink liberally. We don't have to think about, okay, I can only have a drink because I've got to drive or I've got to take a Lyft home and then come back the next day and get my car. Absolutely, just enjoy yourself when you're out and be safe. And the end of the day, what I found, it was about access over ownership. Ownership is what we all default to, but having access started to prove more important than owning a vehicle.
Makes a lot of sense. You know, something I'm curious about that I didn't actually plan on asking, with you and your wife, do you all have children?
No, we don't. And in my blog post, I did mention that children could be a factor that skews this flexibility. But then we also looked at, are you also leveraging all of the things around you, parents and friends, in terms of, you know, babysitters and childcare? We happen in our neighborhood, we have childcare right 0.4 miles from the house. So we have a pre-K there. This elementary school is in walking distance. So I think, you know, we plan on having kids. So I think we will update our findings, update our opinion based on that. But we also have another friend that went through the same journey and they just learned to work with Lyft and Uber and child seats. So there's a feature that many people don't know that you can put in your profile that you have a kid and they'll try and make sure to get you drivers that have child seat accessible cars. So it's not impossible. I haven't personally gone through it, but I think it can be done.
Awesome. I really love what you said about, you know, access versus ownership. I think that is definitely a huge lesson from your journey, but I want you to speak on it yourself. What are some of the great lessons along those lines of access versus ownership that you feel you've embarked upon as a result of this choice?
So it goes beyond the car ownership. It goes into every aspect of life. And when we started going into minimalism, there were things that we owned that didn't make sense. I mean, we had all this lawn care equipment. We had all this stuff for the kitchen and things of that nature that we use very, very little. And my wife is the one who's kind of coined the phrase around 20% of the time. She really